let me stand. I am tired. I am weak. I am worn. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home.
When my brothers and sisters, there is something about the human mind even though reality dictates that death is inevitable and sickness seems sometimes to prolong it and warn us, give us enough notice when it comes. It hits us so hard that we really want to deny it. It is hard to say goodbye. But we come here today to make sure that we eulogize a great human being. A great, great human being. A great wife. A super mother, a great grandmother, a great sister, and more so, a great friend. As indicative of those of you who have turned out here today in spite of the pandemic, that is indicative of the person she was. She has touched many lives. May her soul rest in peace. I had a theological conversation some time ago with a doctor friend, and he said something. He said, energy doesn't die. And I said, you're right. You call it energy, but I call it the soul. It lives on. And as indicated by Scripture, or explicitly stated by Scripture, that the soul of man doesn't die. Our sister is sleeping. Sleep well. The Bible tells us in Job chapter 19, for I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold and not another, though my ruins be consumed within me. These things said he, and after that he said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit Jesus spake of his death, but they taught that he had spoken of taking a rest in sleep. David said, "Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel. Yes, and afterward receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Let not your heart be troubled. He believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." We conclude this reading this morning by the Apostle Paul, who says, "Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord." Valerie, Glasgow, knew the Lord. She loved the Lord. She lived for the Lord. That's what galvanized everything in her life. That's what kept it together, her faith in God. She's in a better place. To Stephen, who is not here and we're praying for, be strong and be encouraged. To her three wonderful children and her grandchildren and all the others, be comforted. From my heart, our deepest condolences. We're praying for you. Let's bow our heads at this time in prayer. Father, we thank you for this morning. The dictates of your word says, "The Lord gives and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." And so we come to celebrate your name as we eulogize our sister, that your name would be glorified, that at the end of this service, others would become conscious, that you will awake that consciousness in us, that life is not just free and just live it carelessly, but God, help us today that we would live it purposefully, with appreciation for life, with appreciation for every breath that we take. And so as our sister lies silent in this casket, Lord, may her voice or her life be loud today, saying to us, think about your mortality. Let your name be lifted up. Let your name be glorified. You alone be praised, O God. Father, thank you for today. And again, thank you for the life of our sister. We bless your name. And we thank you in Jesus' name. And the church say, can I get amen? Amen. Are we going to sing and we're going to shout? We're going to praise God for her life of 69 years. Amen. Can I ask you to celebrate her life now by putting your hands together and giving the Lord a hand of praise as the praise team come and lead us in praise and worship.
Thank you.
shore in that sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall be on that beautiful shore.
It's a privilege and an honor to be here this morning. We're going to go into our first hymn. It is Great is Thy Faithfulness. It is should be in the back of your programs. bless God. In everything, God is still faithful. Amen. Hallelujah.
Faithfulness of God still is here with us to bring us peace and to give us comfort. Good morning, and you know, sincere condolences to the family and the close friends of our dear sister Valerie. How do you sum up the life of a woman who has impacted so many other lives? Because she was an educator, somebody who gave everything to ensure that the people who she interacted with on a daily basis became better because of their encounter. It's hard to do that, but today we'll do our best to honor her life, and not just her life, but to remember her legacy, because I'm sure they are powerful legacies that she's leaving, legacy that she's leaving behind. We'll continue our program today with this morning with the first scripture reading that would be done by Ryan, followed by a tribute of a Salone, and another tribute by Nelly. Immediately after that, we'll have the second hymn. If you are going to be speaking, I'm going to ask you to enter the stage from my left, your right, where you'll be receiving your sanitized microphone. And if you're sitting a little bit from the front, so you're sitting closer to the back, closer when it's your time, I'm going to ask you to make your way to this section. There's a reserved section here for you to be seated, so the time in between speakers is not well delayed. Thank you very much. Ryan, let's come in that order.
From Corinthians chapter 15 verses 50 to 58. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised, imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor is in the Lord is not in vain.
For Nana by Avison and Mommy. My Nana was gracious, kind, and smart. She often spoke with her eyes, but her choices came from her heart. My Nana was loving, funny, and cheerful. Yes, it's true. No matter how rainy the day, her hugs, tickles, and dimples made it brighter for you. My Nana was thankful for everything and everyone in her life. She loved us all, but didn't want us ever to fight. She didn't like to see us cry or feel sad in any way. She always wanted her loved ones to have a happy, happy day. She'd get real serious when I'd make a big mess with my favorite slime. She would get a little frustrated because it would waste a bit of our time. She'd never stay mad though, not for too long. Her lovely smile would be back by the end of a song. I miss my Nana. Making new memories will be hard, but I'm happy I get to keep all the lovely ones we made in our backyard. It's filled with flowers, trees, and trees. Papa helped her plant. She watered them and would tell them stories and shoo away the ants. My Nana loved me, and my little cousin Amaya too. She told me we're both her dream, and she's happy we came true. I miss my Nana. I love her so much. I'll pray so she can hear me, even though I'll miss her touch. Thank you for all your stories and all the cuddles and your ring round chair. Thank you for being my Nana, and thank you for always being there. Thank you for all the time and memories you gave. We love you, Nana. Every day we will be brave. I'll make sure to take care of my mommy. Pinky promise. I know how you have your stress. We're thankful you're in heaven watching all over us.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Nellie Emerald, and I've had the privilege of calling Valerie Glasgow my colleague and friend for the last 30 years. I want to offer my condolences and special thanks to Mr. Stephen Glasgow. We're praying for you and for your family, and to the honor to speak today on behalf of Sinai, Mount Sinai, where she worked, and touch on her career. But I'm also nervous about finding the right words to say to tribute to my mentor and my friend. Valerie started her career at Sinai back in 1983. I started mine almost 10 years later as a nursing student 32 years ago, and Valerie was my preceptor, my teacher, back when she herself was a bedside nurse. We both had moved on to professional development opportunities at Mount Sinai, and since then we often spoke of those early days in our career. Valerie started off with a diploma in nursing. She then did a Bachelor of Science in nursing, and I can remember on our nights working in the break, working on some of her assignments. Valerie did not stop there. She then did a Master's of Science, a Master's of Science in Community Health in Nursing, and then she moved on to a nurse manager role and never looked back. At the same time, she also taught at George Brown College and Ryerson University, and she was cross-appointed at the University of Toronto. Finally, Valerie achieved a Doctor of Education, earning the prestigious title of Dr. Valerie Glasgow. What a personal and professional achievement. Not only has she touched me as part of her Sinai family, if I may share a few words from some of her staff. From her clerical coordinator, each day at work was a special one for both of us, especially our lunchtime or after work shopping adventures. Valerie was not only my manager, she was my mentor, my motivator, my second mom, and cherished friend. I will never forget the impact she had on my life, supporting me in my return back to studies at Ryerson. One of her nurses said she cooked and baked for us and was always supportive of her staff and treated everyone like family. Two other nurses spoke and say Val was always a huge support of the woman in her life. She had extra energy, encouragement, and love for the hardworking mothers in her life and any woman who strived for self-empowerment and improvement. She pushed us to the best possible versions of ourselves. Finally, another one of her nursing staff, we will always miss that twinkle in her eye and the ability to find a reason for a good belly laugh. She was one in a million. Was she ever? During my 30-year career, I've attended a lot of retirement parties, although none like Valerie's back in 2017. She had a steel band playing for her who led a parade throughout the entire unit of mothers who were resting, by the way. They came out of their rooms to watch and celebrate the parade of pink boas, tears, and clapping cheers for Valerie, for Dr. Valerie Glasgow. To Valerie and all the nurses here today, next week starts Nursing Week. She loved Nursing Week. May you all have a wonderful week celebrating your profession and, importantly, the mentors who got you there. Happy Nursing Week.
If you could please stand, we're going to sing the next congregational hymn. It is How Great Thou Art.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds I have made, I see the stars.
My God, how great thou art.
Level sings, my
educator is one thing, but an educator in the health profession is another thing, where you're not just helping one person to create a career for themselves, but you're helping people to help others. That's powerful.
And that's the woman that she was. We heard how Nelly spoke about the impact that she had on her specifically, but not just her, but the staff, the students, and her colleagues as she served with them. We thank her for her years of contribution to the health profession. We'll continue with the second reading by Yvonne, followed by tribute by Barbara and Daria. Hopefully I got that pronunciation correct. Followed by another congregational hymn, a powerful hymn of the faith, Amazing Grace. Let's come in that order.
I just want to do a prayer for my dear sister before I start reading. Lord, welcome into your presence, your daughter of Barbara Glasgow, whom you have called from this life. Release her from all her sins. Bless her with eternal light and peace. Raise her up to live forever with all your saints. In the glory of the resurrection, we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now my second reading will be from Psalm 91, 1 to 16. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely, he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but they shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest they dash their foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample on their feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And thank you all for coming. God be with you all.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Daria Romaniuk. I am here today on behalf of the Daphne Cockwell School of Nursing at Toronto Metropolitan University, formerly Ryerson University. Unfortunately, my colleague Barb Chizzy was not able to join me today. My colleagues at the School of Nursing and I send our deepest condolences to you, Valerie's family and friends, as you remember her today. Valerie taught nursing at our school for over 20 years. Several of my colleagues have shared their memories of Valerie with me, and I would like to share some of those thoughts with you now. Dr. Valerie was seen as a rock that many teachers in our community looked up to. When she worked at Mount Sinai, she supported our clinical instructors and students when they were placed at the hospital. She was a kind and dedicated colleague, a strong and wise leader who always listened first and then shared her perspective. She was always professional and calm, yet warm and friendly. Her warmth and care for people remained at the forefront of her work and interactions. Valerie was dedicated to the growth of her students. She was consistently honest, fair, and encouraging, and helped her students to engage in solution-focused thinking. Of course, working together with someone isn't always all work. Many of her colleagues will miss the friendly conversations they had with Valerie, sharing stories about family and gardens and pictures of grandchildren. Valerie and her friend and colleague Nancy Latimer played the Princess Margaret Lottery together a couple of times. And though they always lost, Valerie took solace in knowing that they had donated to a good cause that helped someone. Valerie was someone who cared about others and was always, always there to help. One of Valerie's colleagues, Corinne Hart, worked closely with Valerie for many years in the third year of our program. While Corinne was not able to attend today, she did offer some words for me to share with all of you. Corinne wrote, "To me, Valerie was a cherished and respected colleague, team member, and friend. She was also an excellent teacher and mentor, both to students and to those with whom she worked. Valerie brought real-life experiences to the classroom and made learning relevant for her students. She was knowledgeable, personable, and sensitive to student needs and issues. She was always willing to go the extra mile for a student in trouble or in distress, and she made them feel safe and supported. Valerie encouraged and supported students to take risks in their learning, providing them with opportunities that they might not otherwise have had. She allowed them to be creative and stretch their ideas about nursing. One of my favorite memories of this is when she was still at Mount Sinai and gave a male nursing student a summer externship on the postpartum unit. In doing so, she helped push against gendered stereotypes of what men in nursing can do and allowed him to learn about women's health in a way that most men in nursing never see. Valerie was an integral part of the year three group. She shared her knowledge and was an active participant in course revisions and team decision making. She was not afraid to challenge ideas, but when she did, it was with respect, kindness, and knowledge. She supported her colleagues and also brought great food to our yearly potluck. Valerie was supportive of me personally and as a faculty member trying to navigate leading year three in challenging times. She checked in on me, cheered me on, and occasionally provided wise counsel. She helped me, like she helped students, feel that I was doing a good job and that she, as a member of my team, had my back. In addition to fond faculty memories, students will also remember Valerie as a truly compassionate teacher, advocate, and ambassador for the nursing profession. She was the type of teacher who was able to channel an everlasting positive energy that uplifted the mood of everyone. Her love of her family was also evident to all students. In fact, one day during a conference on Zoom, Students were even able to meet Valerie's grandchildren as they were crawling in the background in her office. During the end of the winter semester, Valerie mentioned to her students that she was given the option of taking some time off from teaching for her health, but she was determined to finish the semester for her students. On the last clinical practice conference day, Valerie asked her students to repeat the following affirmation. I am loved. I am strong. I am beautiful. This was a very memorable way for students to finish the year and showed Valerie's heartfelt concern for her students. One of Valerie's students wrote a poem, and I would like to share a short passage with all of you. And to the Glasgow family, it was an honor to know Ms. Valerie, a woman that pushed me to my limits and always got the best out of me. I am so thankful for her time with me, a true honor and blessing. I will forever keep her in my prayers as I wish her a peaceful resting. As you can see, Valerie's passing leaves a hole within our school that won't be easily filled. Valerie's strong presence, her careful observations, and her ideas will be missed. She will always be remembered, especially by her students, who gained so much from her expertise. Valerie has left her legacy in this next generation of nurses. Rest peacefully, Valerie. We will miss you. Thank you.
We will stand again. We'll sing the next congregational hymn, It's Amazing Grace. You'll find it in your programs.
Found.
Praise God. You may be seated. His amazing grace is great towards us. Continue our program with a tribute by Sharon, followed by another tribute. Mark and Ryan, Glasgow, followed by the eulogy. And immediately after the eulogy, we'll have a special selection, a solo by Marie English Krishlo. Come in that order, please. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Sharon, and I'm Valerie's youngest sister. Valerie was everything to me. She was my best friend. She was my sister everyone would love to have in their life. My sister was a very caring person, smart, intelligent, and educated. She had a special love of plants and enjoyed gardening. She also loved dancing and traveling. Valerie was a very elegant person and carried herself with class and enjoyed some of the finer things in life. Although I'm very sad and heartbroken, I still wish she was here with me. I will forever remember her lovely smile and may it continue to shine very brightly. I am going to miss her a million times as I shed millions of tears. She will always hold a special place in my heart that cannot be filled by anyone else. I will forever treasure all the wonderful memories of us growing up together and all of the childish things we enjoyed as sisters. She's gone before we know it, and only God knows why. I'm very heartbroken to lose her, but she's not gone alone, for part of me accompany her soul. She's gone, but will never be forgotten. We will forever love you. May your soul rest in peace until we meet again in heaven.
Well, I'm Emmy Vaughn, and I'm Barry's sister as well. My sister was my friend, my counselor, my confidant. She was very kind, loving, ready to give a lending hand everywhere that she possibly can, in whatever situation that she possibly can. My dear sweetheart, nephews and niece, you know my heart is with you. Vari was a daughter, a beautiful mother, who unfortunately could not be here with us today, but our spirit is here. Not here by body and body, but our spirit is here. She had a wonderful husband, one husband, for decades. Beautiful children, three beautiful children, Mark, Ryan, Allison. Don't forget, my heart is with you, and I'm here. You have lost your biological mother, but I'm your second mother. Don't forget now, okay? Don't forget, I am here. You can call me in the middle of the night. You can call me first thing in the morning. Even if I say, I'll come and talk to you on the phone. Okay? And now you're gonna say, Auntie Yvonne, can you get X, Y, and Z? Okay, when? All right? I'm there for you. I'm there for you. God is with you. I pray every day for the Lord to give us all peace, strength, and love in our hearts. And the Lord is grateful and gracious
and he would hear us. Now, I thank each and every one of you for coming here. Nieces, nephews, co-workers, other relatives and friends. And so, may the Lord bless and keep us all. Keep us into his care. God bless. Bye. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Today, we are here to celebrate the honor and the memory of my mother. To explain just how much my mother means to me is an impossible task. But I want to make sure that I pay tribute to my mother. My mother was the strongest, bravest, and kindest human being. Without her, I wouldn't be the person I am, and I wouldn't have the life that I have. She is everything to me in many ways. My mother was an amazing woman with a heart of gold. A leader, driven, humbled, intelligent, and selfless. Despite everything that she went through, Mom always went above and beyond for everyone. Even though she is not here physically, her memories and spirit is alive and will always be in my heart. Thank you, Mom, for everything.
Good morning. It's good to see you. Really. Valerie Glasgow, you know her? Some of you, Valerie was a colleague, a sister, an aunt, a daughter, a cousin, a professor, a mentor, a leader. Valerie Glasgow was all of those things and more. For us, to me, this is my mom. The parent, the educator, the healer, the queen of cuddles. My mom. I won't say anything like I won't forget her. None of us ever will. Some of us would never try. I remain convinced that Mom is not truly gone. She's just in a different place, a better place, waiting like the rest, eternally blessed. Your Valerie was our mom. I remember her and I miss so many things. Just a minute. Remember in the mid-80s, this is how Mom would call us, that or Ryan. Just a minute, it meant, come here, son, so we can discuss why you can't clean up your room. Just a minute. I would run, yes, Mom, I'm coming, Mom. I'm gonna miss her dumplings, her hugs, the way she would make me bring her hibiscus plants in from the backyard because the winter's coming. We had to go bring in the plants, you know? Yeah. Much more than a mother, we miss her. I miss her. I remember Mom. And when I do, I remember love. My mom loved me, and I loved her back. My mom always made sure that I felt and understood love, this family, this love. Because truly, that's all she ever wanted. And that is all we ever needed. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Some of you know me fairly well, while others haven't seen me in quite some time. And yet, for a good few of you, this may be your very first introduction. I'm Allison, or Princess, my princess. My mom called me. If you knew of our mom, if you cared for her, if you've ever been graced with her warm smile and mischievous grin, if she has impacted your life in any way, I respectfully invite you to please raise your hand. Please. Now take a moment to look around you. Keep it up, please. Look around this room at every hand that's raised. We are connected. We are forever bonded by the beautiful privilege we all share in her touching all our lives. As I look across the room today, I'm reminded of the woman Dr. Valerie Mae Glasgow was, not just as a phenomenal mother, my father's devoted wife, or even my daughter and niece's doting Nana, but who she was to all of you. Family, friends, colleagues, students, to the community. Our mom, she had captivating eyes that often spoke for her without uttering a sentence. She gave thoughtful advice, but always from an honest place. She wouldn't shy away from holding you up during your most difficult times. She was many things to many of us here: confidant, mentor, therapist, five-star chef, human lie detector, beloved ally. She invested in others. That was her nature, her calling, well before my siblings and I were even thought of. She was hard not to love. She was special. And that's what makes this part of her journey so much harder for us to bear. Born in St. Catharines, Jamaica, to Septimus, our grandfather who passed, and Myrtle Lewis, who, God willing, will turn 102 this year. Our mom was the middle child with 7 siblings. That in itself explains a few things, specifically her ability to observe, listen, and process any situation with an amazing poker face, whether pleasant or stern. I suspect this is where her love of people watching started. Growing up in a big family garners experiences that mold your life and are shared later in memories. My auntie Sharon, mom's youngest sister, shared an early memory of how devoted mom was to attending church. My aunt told me mom would always come home for her while away at Dunrobin High School in Kingston. She would bring her to town every holiday, and each time, Open Bible Pentecostal Church, being a second home to mom, was a part of my aunt's visit. Mom's faith, her love of God, was a sacred part of who she was, even in her youth, and this never left her. Mom and I often spoke about her time in Jamaica. She'd share stories as if it were the other day. I'd ask questions like, what were you like when you were my age at different points in my life? Or how did you have the nerve to be so amazing? My mom would circle back to where it started, her discipline, her focus on setting goals and working hard. She shared what it was like for her at school. Like most West Indian parents, she was keen to point out it took miles, not minutes, to get there. She enjoyed learning, but admitted it was challenging. She told me different stories of my Auntie Vaughn, her older sister, pushing her to study often under candlelight during her time at Ginger Ridge Elementary School. Many of her mom's peers have always mentioned how naturally bright and gifted she was, but my mom credits my aunt in supporting the importance of routine and education at home first. Being entrusted with these memories helped me appreciate who our mom was and continued to be throughout our lives. Places can stir nostalgia and memories, even if they're not your own. 3 words: Christy Pitts Park. This is where my parents claim to have met. I've been told this questionable story forever. It was a Sunday. My mom was watching a little girl who also was named Valerie. And my dad saw her, tried to speak to her, and my mom wasn't having any of it. So the following Sunday, my dad made sure to only speak to the little girl. And apparently this softened my mom's heart long enough to take my dad's business card with no business on it. Yes, my dad was slick and charming enough to have his name, number, at the ready, on a decent stock of paper in the 70s, to hand to my mom in that Toronto park. I always questioned the authenticity of this story. My parents would tell it together in unison, almost like a song. It was such a wholesome story. Mom told me after they met, they would talk on the phone for hours. My dad would tell me the same thing, except his version included a payphone and a begrudged line of people waiting. My parents would have passionate differences of opinion. And they'd often make friendly bets over the most random things that ended in my dad or my mom handing over $5 in between barrels of laughter. Their friendship changed my mind over time, and I eventually believed this story. In the way my parents would dance at every party, how my dad would reach for my mother's hand while he was driving and she'd hold it back tightly. The amount of times I found them snuggled sleeping as if there was no other way. It's in their love I know the Christie Pitts Park story is true. Without that park, that business card, mom's kind nature, my brothers and I wouldn't exist, nor would all the beautiful memories we share. People propel memories in what they say, in who they tell, in the questions they ask. For as long as I can remember, people would ask me, do you know who your mother is? My 9-year-old self would say, yeah, the lady who'd send me to school in crinoline when everyone else was wearing jogging pants. As I got older, I'd hear the same question. Do you know who your mother is? I'd think about the insanely incredible feats my mother pursued and achieved, how dedicated she was to equity, how invested she was in seeing others succeed and find their path. She was an educator, a leader, a scholar. But as Ryan said, she was also my mom. Once my mom wrapped her PhD, we would watch Mob Wives after spending a couple hours at the Bay shopping. She would get calls at all hours from everyone. She'd always make time, and I have no idea how she did it. Yes, her mom was adored socially and respected professionally, but I realized mom balanced her priorities like a dance. Not just any dance, but the hardest tango you could choreograph. My mother's legacy is with us in the work she did, the lessons she taught, the people she loved, and the heart she warmed. I witnessed mom's soul leave this earth, her remarkably thoughtful soul ascended. Our mother has now embarked on a journey without pain, after fulfilling a life of purpose, and she is now wrapped in an abundance of peace. I would like to close with an email I sent to her almost 12 years ago to the day, and the subject line reads, "Not because it's Mother's Day." Mom, you are the most beautiful woman I know. Inside and out, you continuously prove to your family, friends, and community that you not only give willingly, but you give for the sake of growth. I am thankful for the various gifts you have given me, specifically the gifts of love and compassion. With every hug, with every kiss, with every supportive word, and with every passionate scream, I appreciate the impact you have made and continue to make on my life. I love you, adore you, and appreciate all aspects of your imperfections. You are a remarkable woman, an amazing mother, and I thank God every day for your presence in our lives. Thank you for giving me the privilege of being my mom. Thank you.
We worship you, O Lord. You are worthy to be praised. You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you, O Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Can we praise the Lord? You are Alpha and you're Omega. We worship you, oh Lord. You are worthy to be praised. We have any Pentecostals in the church? We give you all the glory. We worship you, oh Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Lord, we want to worship you. We Valerie. 2 days before Valerie went in the hospital, she was on my back about my health. She wanted to insist, Marie, do this. You have to. She said, I didn't even know Valerie was ill. She said to me, this is hard for me. Go back to the doctor. And this is what you say to him. If you, Marie, were his sister, or if you were his wife, what would he recommend? That's what she said to me 2 days before she went to the hospital. So I can't sing a regular song this morning. I just have to stand here and thank God for this person and to say, Lord God, we worship you and we adore you. And no matter what it is, this is not our home. And I'm not preaching. I don't do this normally, Bishop. But this is a special person to me. So, we worship you, oh Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
We're truly sorry that Stephen could not be here. We're asking you to pray for him, that God would extend his life. Not just extend his life, but give him quality life. I really want to say thanks to the children, her children, for the way you have stood here this morning and, like I said before, eulogize your mother. Thank you so much. I listened to the nurses, her colleagues. She was a very special woman. I want to challenge you for the next few minutes, and this would be very short, about the question, and why am I here? God has blessed me over the past 41 years as a pastor. I have, the last 2 years, I have seen and have done so many funerals that I never dreamt that I would have encountered all those dead people. The 2 years been very challenging. There were Saturdays when I had to do two funerals right here. And sometimes people would want to put in another one. But God has kept us who are alive here, and we can celebrate. I really want to recognize and celebrate those who are here from the medical profession or in that field. You have done a phenomenal job. You are the frontline workers, or you are. When others were hiding, you had to be there. I salute all of you. As a matter of fact, I'm going to ask all the nurses and the support workers to stand here this morning. Please, please, don't be afraid. Stand up, stand up. Folks, we owe our lives to these people. And when you see them, please, for God's sake, salute them. Salute them. Appreciate them. And if you're in a restaurant, you may be seated. And if you're in a restaurant and you come across any of them, walk up to the cashier and pay for their meals. I believe in that. I've done that. I respect you. I honor you. You know what it is to be sick and somebody come by your bedside and give you life. We salute you. And so again, Valerie, you've done so much for our world that we do not know how to repay you. But one thing we are truly confident in is that God has given you your reward. May you sleep well. There is a text that I have looked on many times, obviously, as a reader of scripture. One who does not only read it, but one who has taught the scripture and have done that literally around the world. I have looked at this text, Genesis chapter 2, time and time again. And each time it comes out from the pages of scripture, so profoundly powerful. It reads, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." I could have the conversation here this morning and we could talk about our existence and why we're here and the creation of man. And we could talk about Darwin and his theory and we could talk about all of that. But I have come to the conclusion that Darwin must have been somewhat drunk when he came up with the Big Bang Theory. I love to read, and there's a book that I am now looking at by the name. The title is How God Preserved Civilization. And the author said something, life is always moving towards chaos. And for everything to operate the way it does, tells us that there is a mastermind behind creation. There's another book that is written by some great scientists, and the title of it is Show Me God. And when I read what the conclusion of some men who have literally recant their story or their theory about God, it tells me that only a man who is somewhat really warped can conclude that there is no God, because the man who opens his eyes sees some things that he cannot explain naturally. And that is the reality, that there is a God. But I'm not going to go down that avenue this morning. I simply want to take you to a simple story. In an episode of a TV program called CSI New York, a young man was cleaning his wife's things out of the house. They had been stored in a closet for many years, and he could not bring himself until recently to deal with the pain of sorting through her things. You see, tragically, his wife had been one of the victims of 9/11, that terror attack on the Twin Towers in New York. And so he had spent many lonely years trying to get over what had happened on that terrible, fateful day that we all remember. And so one by one, he would painstakingly throw away an item or sort out things to give away. He came to a beach ball, a cheap beach ball. And after considerable thought, he could not bring himself to throw it away. Finally, he tucked it carefully back into the closet. You see, my brothers and sisters, why did he do that? It wasn't the value of the beach ball that he did not want to get rid of it. As I said, it was a cheap beach ball. Because on their last vacation together, they had purchased the ball for just a dollar and some cents. But something happened. His wife, his loving wife, was the one who inflated the ball with her breath. And he simply could not bring himself to throw it away. Why? Because it contained the precious breath of his wife. She had breathed into that cheap ball, that flat piece of colorful plastic, and that flat piece of colorful plastic became a ball. There, the beach ball was filled to capacity with life. It could bounce, it could float, fly through the air, and it brought howls of happiness to all of them on their last vacation. All because somebody inflated that ball. Cheap. I want you to think about this for a moment. The Bible says, and the Lord God formed man from what? Cheap dirt. Everywhere in the world, you can just pick up dirt cheap. There's no value in dirt itself. We could talk about time to take all the good minerals out of it, but dirt by itself seemed to have no value. But the Bible says God formed man from dirt. But God did something. He breathed into man his breath, and man became valuable. From nothing to something. Why? Because it contained the very breath of God. I could spend some time here this morning and talk about why did God use dirt and not gold and silver. Number one, I firmly believe that God sometimes wants to bring us back to reality, because if left by ourselves, we exaggerate who we are. And we put value sometimes on things that we need not to put value on, and forget the most important things in life. There are many of us, yes, she was an educator, and if you ever come to this church, you would have known that from this pulpit, I have preached and established scholarships around the world and encouraged education. We have turned our gymnasium into what we call a youth empowerment program, YEP. And so on a Saturday, I would have gathered the mathematicians, the people who are in actuary science who understand math. I would have gathered the people here who are in medicine or whatever who understand science. I would have gathered the English teachers and I've allowed them to volunteer here and would have taught our students who have failed on a personal level. So I believe in education. And I've watched students who were failures moved on from being failures to have gone on to medical school. So much so, teachers have asked us, what have we done with these students? So I believe in education. But sometimes we exaggerate who we are because of an education. That is not what makes us a person. Because, you know, I came across a quote once, John Maxwell. He says, life is about one's attitude. Because sometimes it's not one's attitude, not aptitude determines one's altitude. Some people are bright, but you can't promote them. You don't want to be around them. They are just so obnoxious. And so if we're not careful, we use that to define us without other stuff. And so God, there are many of us who defined ourselves by the cars we drive, the houses we live in. But life is more than that. The Bible says God created us from what? Dirt. What is most important is that God breathed of himself in us and we became something. So my brothers and sisters, the most important thing in life is not the external, is what God has deposited in us. And so this morning as she lies there, this body will return to the ground from whence it came. What is important and what will live on is the soul that God has breathed into her. You know, the question to you today is, why are you here? Miles Monroe said, and I quote, the greatest tragedy in life is not death, but life without a reason. He went on to say it's dangerous to be alive and not know why you were given life. Why were you given life? There is no statistical accident sitting here. None of us are here by accident. We are here because an intelligent God decided to create us. And my brothers and sisters, because I know that life doesn't stop at death, at death, one will go on to meet his Savior and Lord. What are you doing with the life that God has placed you here on earth for? Have you discovered the purpose why you were given life? So in conclusion here this morning, I think the greatest man sums it up best, why God breathed into us. And that is Solomon. He says, let's hear the conclusion of the whole matter. What he was talking about there is life. Let's hear the conclusion why God gave us life. To fear God and keep his commandment. The word fear comes from a Hebrew word which means to acknowledge with reverence. There is a God. The man who opens his eyes sees God on every side. Therefore, the Bible declares, the heavens declare, and the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. There is a God, and a God to be served, a God to acknowledge. It's not just to live and die, my friends. Hence, life would have been miserable. And so I implore you today, as she lies here cold, as she lies here lifeless, yet in her death, she's saying to her friends, her colleagues, her family members, she's speaking loudly by saying, one day you will come to this conclusion, and one day you will have to face the master for yourself, because life will come to an end. but you must acknowledge why you were given life. She did. She acknowledged that, and she acknowledged her God and served him like Solomon. May her soul rest in peace, but may you continue to think about why you were given life. You know, it is interesting. A few years ago, I had gone to a funeral. I was doing a funeral for another colleague who had died, and here's one of my batchmates coming to the funeral, walking towards me, strong and healthy. And somehow, you know, there's this thing, they call it premonition. I don't know, or intuition. I don't know which of them. I was just piercing him. Can I tell you? The following week, the strong man was the one that we were burying. In other words, what I'm trying to say, we do not know when this is going to come to an end. I'm glad a lot of you are here from the medical profession. You have seen it all. You've seen the young, you've seen the old, you've seen the stillborn. And so I say to you today, think about life while you were given it. There is a God to serve. There is a real God, not an idea. And may you come to the place where you will acknowledge that there is a God. Let us pray. Lord, I want to thank you today for the Glasgow's family. Stephen, Lord, right now, who might be held up in a hospital, that Almighty Father, in the name of Jesus, that you'll touch his body. Give him strength. Open his mind. But Lord, I pray that you'll touch his body and let her health be restored. I pray today for Valerie's children, that God, you'd bless them and that you'll cover them. I pray for her grandchildren. Lord, I pray today also for all her friends and relatives. Give them grace. We thank you and we bless you in Jesus' name. And we all say, amen. Before the person comes to give the vote of thanks, the funeral director will be coming and will be instructing us. I'm going to ask us to listen carefully to the funeral director. But also the family members have prepared for all of you a meal. And because of the pandemic, we're not going to sit down. We want you immediately after you leave here, walk through the gymnasium, collect your meal, go to your car, and we're going to head to the cemetery. I walked out a while ago, and what I smell inside the gymnasium, I wanted to go and have some, but I realized that I had to get back here. So immediately after, please walk through the gym, collect your meal, head to your cars. We're heading straight to the cemetery. At this time, I'm going to ask, there's a name there. Would you come? Let me call your name. Is it Aileen Felix? Would you come and give the vote of thanks? And then the funeral director is going to give us instructions. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Eileen Felix, and I am Stephen's sister. Valerie is my sister-in-law. Many of you may have heard about Auntie Bonnie. I am the Auntie Bonnie. When I was asked to do this, and my brother spoke to me a few days ago, I said, yes, I'd do it, and I had everything all set. He said, you know, you follow the program and this sort of thing. But then when I spoke to him earlier today, I lost it. Really lost it. And previously, when he told me that Valerie was not coming home to the house, I lost it that morning. I said, what you mean? Not the house? Is she getting better? And then I came to terms with reality. So Valerie's passing, and then this morning, and when Stephen could not be here, I know how much meant to him. And with his absence, it makes me feel very, very sad. But I thank all of you for coming here. Grief has brought us together in celebration of her life. I need not go over all the great things that Valerie has done and the impact she has had on our lives in the various spheres where she touched. When she joined our family, we welcomed her. And I said, oh no, we have a big family. Because on one hand, Stephen is from a smaller family. I am the older sister. And we were one of two. And I can tell you, the loss of a mother is painful. And every day to be fresh in your minds. Stephen and I lost our mother over 50 years ago, and it's just like yesterday. But God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Special thanks go out to all the participants in this morning's program, and particularly to those officials from the Mount Sinai community, the Mount Sinai Hospital. Since we cannot name all names and all representatives, every one of you from Mount Sinai, we are thankful for. Our gratitude goes out. And then from the Ryerson community, the School of Nursing and the faculty, all the people with whom she interacted, and you interacted with her, the grace, and you have taken the time off to come and be with us this morning for her friends, her traveling buddies. I remember some faces from a cruise on which we were together. I think about Adele. I think, you know, all the names, and I remember. I thank you for the part you played in their lives. And I want you to keep Stephen in your hearts. Keep him in prayer. Keep him in prayer. It is particularly touching and hard for me because some of the things from which he suffers, I suffer too. Yes, physically. And in a nutshell, doctors say it doesn't skip generations. It doesn't skip generations. But we are battling, and we can make it. To the priest, the pastor of the church, all the singers, thank you. Your voices and the depth has touched us all. Remember Allison, the youngest of the trio, Mark and Valerie, Mark and Ryan. You have Aunt Bunny. Stephen has a family, a small family. My daughter is here with me, and there are one or two others. But don't you feel that you have nobody? Your father has a family, and we'll keep in touch. We don't have to be in each other's pockets to be in touch. But I want publicly to say that I will ask of them to keep in touch with this Aunt Bunny, and Aunt Bunny will. I answer the phone at any time. And it's not, well, oh, I can't call after a certain hour. No. My daughter had been away from boarding school before she was 12. She went to school in Connecticut, and we lived in New York. So when the phone rang at any time, I must answer the phone because I have somebody out there. And my brother knows, but he said, no, I'm not going to call her. I'll call her in the morning. When he called me from the hospital the first time and he was there, 6 o'clock, I said, who's calling now? That got to be Aaron. When I picked up, he said, Bonnie, I'm in hospital, and so on. But life goes on. He has a family. You have a family. I was surprised to see Ava. Oh, I said, she had grown. Yes. To all of you, thank you. Valerie, may your soul rest in peace and rise in glory. You will never be forgotten. Here is Ryan.
Thank you, Auntie Bunny. I don't have anything prepared to say, but I wanted to let you know that my father wanted to be here, and many of you know him. I want you to keep my dad, Stephen, Mr. Glasgow, in your mind, in your thoughts, in your prayers, in your thoughts, in your prayers, in your thoughts, and your prayers. He wanted to be here. He's not here now. And we're all hoping that he's going to storm into the driveway, speeding way too fast. But let us proceed with the day. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Glasgow family, I would like to thank everyone for attending Valerie's service. For those of you who are able to join us on the live stream, we thank you as well. This now concludes Valerie's service. The entombment will take place at a later date, so we will not be going to the cemetery today. As Bishop had mentioned, as a token of thanks and appreciation for your prayers and blessings over the last few weeks, the family has arranged to have some refreshments for you. So once you exit the sanctuary, you're welcome to proceed directly to the gym to pick up your meal to enjoy on your way home. And once again, to the Glasgow family, I would like to thank you for allowing us to serve you. Thank you.